classes of subterranean organisms. One is trogofauna, which are air-breathing organisms, and the other is stygofauna. They're not air-breathing, but they live in the aquatic aquifers underground. So these are examples of some of the groups that I'll be talking about today. We have different groups of arachnids. There are schizomids, pseudoscorpions, spiders, harvestmen, scorpions, hexapods, including insects. We have diplurans, cave cockroaches, subterranean beetles, in this case a diving beetle, plant bugs feeding on root mats underground. There are also myriapods, including millipedes, these are blind millipedes, centipedes and symphyons, and crustaceans, which also straddle both the trogofauna spaces and the stygofaunal spaces. So we have things like slaters, this isopod here, part of the trogofauna. There are amphipods and copepods and a couple of other smaller groups as well. Now quickly I'd like to introduce the environmental impact assessment process in Western Australia, although you'll hear a lot more about this tomorrow in Bridget Hyder's talk. But usually the system in Western Australia is that the proponent conducts pre-impact surveys, which are usually outsourced to environmental consulting companies. And they are obliged to sample for subterranean fauna as well as other short-range endemic species, I'll explain this shortly, plant communities, invertebrates, etc. The proponent then submits to their environmental impact assessment report, eventually to the Western Australian Office of the Environmental Protection Authority. The report is considered by the EPA board. Recommendation is submitted to the West Australian Minister for the Environment, and the Minister announces the decision. That's in a nutshell, basically, the process. It will set the scene for what I'm going to talk about today. As I mentioned, Bridget's talk tomorrow will go into more detail. And I mentioned the West Australian Wildlife Conservation Act before. In that act, all species are protected under the act, whether they're subterranean or surface. And there are a series of guidance statements that are available. The West Australian Act in the 1950s was so broad that it just mentioned fauna, which actually encompasses invertebrates as well as vertebrates. So it's a little bit of an historical accident that we've been able to include invertebrate work under this act, because in other states in Australia, that's not necessarily the case. They're not mentioned specifically, and only plants and vertebrate organisms are mentioned, and so they're unable to act on their conservation. So we're a little bit lucky with this old act that we still use. Now, I mentioned before about short-range endemic species that also need to be surveyed for as part of our conditions, the EIA process in Western Australia. Short-range endemic species are those taxa with naturally small distributions that are prescribed by environmental factors including geography, habitat, and ecology. It can include surface and subterranean taxa. In particular, surface taxa might be things like, we have many species of trapdoor spiders in Australia that are short-range endemics, very, very small distributions. And I published a paper in 2002 which explained this entire process in an Australian journal. Short-range endemic taxa have a series of limiting factors that ecologically define them. One of them is they normally have poor dispersal capabilities, so they're generally unable to fly. They have no dispersive immature stages. They're tied to specific habitats. Surface species might be tied to gullies, south-facing slopes. Is that you? Is this being translated for you? We can translate. But they're also, we're talking about subterranean organisms. They can be found in caves and other subterranean spaces. Often the activity patterns are seasonal, especially in the surface species. And in that paper, I define short-range endemic species as anything that had a distribution of less than 10,000 square kilometres. Now that was literally devised by multiplying 100 kilometres by 100 kilometres. It's not particularly scientific, but it's used as a benchmark in Australia, in Western Australia, to assess whether something is a short-range endemic species or not. And using this series of definitions, virtually all subterranean fauna fits the category of short-range endemism. Now I'm going to walk you through two examples of two different places in Western Australia where we've done a lot of work on subterranean organisms to explain some of the challenges that have been put before us over the last 15, 20 years. The first is a peninsula off the north called the Northwest Cape, called Cape Range. It has a mountain range in the middle of it here, sits up here in Western Australia. It's limestone karst, two different sorts of karst that lie above each other, one on top of the other. Extensive cave systems. There are hundreds of caves that have now been found in the area. And it wasn't until the 1980s that subterranean fauna was discovered. Arachnids, hexapods, millipedes, crustaceans, etc., including two species of blind fish, some of the only troglobitic vertebrates in all of Australia. The entire range is heavily dissected due to erosion. You can see all these erosional patterns here running down to the coast on either side of the peninsula. And what we found through many years of study of organisms in the Cape Range region is that there are very, very predictable patterns of distributions. So they're probably responding to very similar events in the past over the last few million years. The first pattern, one of the patterns that we can see, these are distribution points of three different species of a genus called Draculoides, which is a Schizoma genus. We'll talk about Schizoma shortly. We have a main species living in the caves in the middle of the range, one on the west coast and one centred on the east coast. Looking at troglobitic millipedes, we basically see exactly the same pattern. There's a species in red here that's found right throughout the range. There's a species on the west coast that's actually signified that sits under that red dot there where the arrow is. There's another yellow species that's there and also underneath that red dot. And superimposing those distributions along with a number of other groups of organisms, we find these, as I said, predictable patterns of one species in each genus having multiple species, some in the centre, some in the west, some in the east. So these are historical processes that these organisms have evolved under for the last few million years. But the area that I really want to talk about just now is the Pilbara bioregion. This region is a natural bioregion that occurs up in northwestern Australia. And there's huge levels of extraction of minerals, including predominantly iron ore, but also others such as gold, right throughout the entire region. And these mining operations have become quite widespread through the, as we've heard this morning, the demand for iron ore in markets, especially in places like China. So there are actually no true caves in the Pilbara region. So there's no caves you can walk into or climb into. And in fact, the entire region, though, is highly weathered, and there are numerous subterranean cavities. So they were really only discovered when drill cores, such as this one here, were put in place by the mining companies to assess the ore or to tap into the aquifer. And the drill cores came back up, and you can see this space here. This one's about as thick as your finger. But there are other spaces as well. So sometimes these cores come up, some as big as football here in Brazil, much more important than a basketball, and sometimes big spaces as well. So you can't actually get down into them. So we sample them using indirect sampling. So this is a drill bore here. This is my colleague Bill Humphreys, who has placed sterilized leaf litter into a plastic trap that has holes in it, lowers it down into the bore on fishing line, ties it off, comes back in 3 months' time. Some of the organisms have actually moved into the leaf litter, take it back up and then sample. So it's indirect sampling. You can also lower containers down into the water table, into the aquifer, and with a net, drag up the stygofauna up into the surface. So it's indirect sampling. Now, none of this fauna was known until the 1990s, when people like Bill started to drop traps down these boreholes just to see if there was any fauna down there, and there certainly was a lot of fauna. So So we've already heard this morning about an environmental impact assessment that was placed against a mine called Mesa A in the Pilbara, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. It's quite an interesting case. These are piezolite mesas, very rich in iron ore, that channel iron deposits that were deposited in a Paleo River drainage channel between 12 and 25 million years ago. The river's since dried out, and since that time has weathered and formed individual mesas shaped like this one here that are separated from each other down the Paleo River basin. The mining company has wanted to mine each of these individual mesas for piezolite to extract iron ore, other products. And you can see the outline of one here in this photograph. And this is the Paleo River channel to the side here. Now, doing the pre-impact surveys in these mesas, they were actually looking for stygofauna and started to pull up examples of troglofauna, including schizomers, these little spider-like animals that we've heard a little bit about today. These are two different species which we've described in the past. They're sometimes called micro-whip scorpions, and they're small arachnids distantly related to spiders. In Australia, they're mostly tropical, so you get them in tropical rainforest areas here in the north and in the east. But in some parts of Australia, we have subterranean species living in mostly in caves. This is the Chiligo region, Katakata Caves, the southern Kimberley in northern Western Australia. And all of these species here, nearly all of these species here are subterranean ones in the Pilbara, and they're the ones I'm going to be talking about. Now, the history of discovery of schizomers in Western Australia is actually fairly recent. So the first species was described, I described the first species in 1988 from Cape Range, and I famously said to my colleagues at the time, no other species of schizomer will be found in Western Australia, especially because all of this is desert and semi-arid regions through here. So I remember saying that to someone, no other species will be found. I was totally wrong, completely wrong. So within the next decade, there were four more species that had been found on Cape Range, and a species also on Barrow Island, which is off the coast of Western Australia. In the next 10 years, the next decade, there are further nearly 30 species discovered using the sampling methods I was just talking about, using the glitter traps coming up from the surface. And in the following 6 years, we recognise a total of 83 species from across the entire landscape. Basically, everywhere in the Pilbara where mining activity wishes to occur, mining companies want to place their mines, obliged to do these surveys, one of the groups they turn up is schizomers. So it's an interesting case study. They're important indicators, and they are very widespread and very easily collected in all subterranean environments in the Pilbara. Now, what we've discovered by looking at these species, looking at the specimens, is that there are many different species. The distributions are highly disjunct. You virtually find no sympatry. That means that you never find two species in the same habitat, in the same mesa or the same caste system. They're highly allopatric. And all of them are short-range endemics, and all of them have very natural small distributions. This is one subsection of the Pilbara. It shows one section here. There are 23 species in this area here. Just to simplify the map a little bit, that shows the distributions of each of the ones. These are some of the ones in the Rogue River Valley I was just talking about. Many new species are found right throughout these southern areas. To assist looking at the morphology, assessing the morphology of these species, we also use sequence data to show that they've been separated from each other for about a million years, which is about the time that the mesas started to weather and separate from each other. So there's been no gene flow for a million years, which has slowly led to speciation. And these are the mesas that sit down this Paleo River channel. Every single one of these separate mesas has its own separate species of schizomer and other subterranean organisms. So when the proposal was put to the EPA about whether this one mesa, the the mine at Mies Array, which is this one here, this left-hand slide. Initially, the application for the mine was not approved, largely because of the troglodytic fauna that was going to be affected, including the schizomid and five other endemic, short-range endemic species that were only found in Tobias Mies, but nowhere else, despite considerable sampling. So at the time, in 2007, this was the front page headline of the Western Australian newspaper, which is the newspaper in Perth where I live. And on page seven was the cartoon that we got. So I thought that was pretty good that we got the cartoon in the newspaper. Okay, normally it's only for politicians. It's unfortunate that they've drawn a spider and it's got eyes, because it was actually a schizomid with no eyes. But you take what you can get, right? So, and as we've heard today, it was a $12 billion iron ore industry that was at risk. So it was lampooned and discussed in the media considerably for a few days. After appeal, the EPA approved the mine, but with a reduced footprint. So we've already seen some maps today of that habitat, the mining exclusion zone that was discussed and then agreed to by the mine, leaving these habitat islands as fauna protection zones. But I believe that we have no data to suggest that the troglofauna will survive in these zones in perpetuity. It's just it's a guess about whether it's going to actually occur or not. I mentioned before about schizomids being widespread across the Pilbara. Unfortunately, there are only two species that are situated inside the conservation estate, that is within national parks or other reserves. Barrow Island, which is a reserve, a conservation reserve, but is heavily exploited for oil exploration. And also this year, I found a new epigean species in this national park, the first epigean species in all of Pilbara. The rest are all subterranean. All of the rest of these species all reside on mining leases, and some of them are active mines. Since then, we've been able to start sequencing many, many different species of schizomids across all of Pilbara. This is preliminary results. You can see that Cape Range has different groups that have evolved in Cape Range. It suggests that the fauna is very, very old, tens of millions of years old. I won't go into too many details there. As I mentioned before, the EPA requirements are there in pre-impact surveys to establish whether subterranean fauna is present or not. And we need accurate identifications of the organisms. So, and also, do the species also occur outside of the impact zone? So proponents are encouraged to survey outside of anywhere that they want to impact. Because if they do find something that's unusual, then it's very difficult to get out of that tight space. And if they do find something that will be impacted, how is that going to be managed? And I don't have time to go into that in detail. So usually, I work in a museum, I do identifications of organisms. They're normally based on morphology. It requires expert taxonomists, of which we do not have enough, and it requires suitable life stages of specimens that are being collected. Normally, we need adults. You cannot identify juvenile specimens. So we've been developing and using DNA sequence data for the last few years to try and assist us, and it's, as I mentioned, difficult to identify many specimens, what I call an inappropriate life stage. So it might be a juvenile specimen, or it might be a female in groups where the only good taxonomic characters might be in the male genitalia. And often we might find cryptic species using DNA work as well. It allows us to accurately identify these life stages, and there's less reliance on expert taxonomists. So it doesn't mean that I have to sit down in a microscope and identify everything. We use sequence data, and we can assign things very quickly. It's very cheap and very easy, and we concentrate on one particular gene, cytochrome oxidase 1, of which there is now an international database of hundreds of thousands of sequences, including a lot of Western Australian troglobitic organisms already on this database. We can use it to generate these large phylogenetic trees. This is an example of a small part of this tree. So once you get hundreds of specimens in, you can generate these sorts of data. But it's particularly useful when you have a known identifications of known taxa. And in this case, this is a series of trapdoor spiders. where these ones in yellow were seeking identifications. We couldn't use morphology because they were not adult. Using sequence data, we were able to show that, get an accurate identification, and more importantly, show that these were species or clades that had already been sampled. We already know they knew their distributions. And so the proponent was able to say, well, this is not a unique species. This has already been found somewhere else. Occasionally, we do turn up clades, groups that haven't been found somewhere else, and then the search is on to try and find them in another location and make sure they're not impacted if the proposal goes ahead. It's accurate, it's objective, it's inexpensive, and we can share data between government and resource companies and scientists. And summing up, I think there's large amounts of extra research that's still needed on subterranean organisms in many parts of the world, including Western Australia. We now know of several thousand species of subterranean animals that live in the Pilbara region of Western Australia. But what we're lacking are things like ecological data. We know nothing about ecophysiological tolerances. What happens to them when 3/4 of the habitat they occur in is taken away during the extraction process? The water table might be lowered. Is this going to affect them? Most likely it will. We know nothing about trophic interactions of these organisms. We know very, very little about demographic and life history data. We certainly know nothing about effective population size, but we're going to start exploring that shortly using genetic techniques, hopefully, because you can use some pretty cool algorithms to work that out with genetic data. And we're also very interested in genetic bottlenecking, especially into the future. Some of these mesas that things like schizomans live in are only a few hundred hectares in size. So if you take out 70% of that habitat, you're going to be left with a very small number of individuals. Does this have any effect on the population viability into the future? We have no idea. We're also starting to work on using environmental DNA techniques, including next generation sequencing. I'm involved in a large grant from the Australian Research Council, which is the primary funding agency for science in Australia. And we're going to start using environmental DNA techniques to sample things like aquifers. So all you need is a jar of water, and the theory is you should be able to work out which species of stygofauna occur in that aquifer without having to sample and identify the specimens. You can get the DNA, fragments of the DNA from the water column itself, stitch them together, and find out what's down there. Very quick sampling techniques. We're not sure we can do it for troglofauna just yet. We're going to focus on stygofauna initially. We've only just started that work this year. So the aim in Western Australia, as in many other jurisdictions, is to avoid extinctions and other serious environmental impacts on the biodiversity. And in Western Australia, each subterranean species is protected. And it should be by protection of some undeveloped habitat. We talked before about leaving exclusion zones across the landscape. In Western Australia, there is no need to formally describe and name the species to formally recognise it by government and proponents. In fact, we can list these as threatened species without having to formally describe and name them. We just give them code names. We're doing that quite regularly. We believe that we've got world-leading practical solutions, which we hope will help conservation efforts into the future. And we ensure that all decisions are based on the most authoritative and up-to-date information, including genetic data, across all of the organisms. And as I said before, come to Bridget's talk tomorrow, she'll be able to explain it. I'd like to thank all of the organisers of this symposium and all of the collaborators and funding agencies who funded my research. Thank you very much. I finished right on time.
Congratulations. Right on time.
Thank you, Mark. Excellent presentation and totally fitting in the objectives of the seminar. So we have time for a number of questions. We have 10 minutes, so please raise your hands and identify yourself.
I'm Rodolfo from ITV Bene. Thank you for the talk. You mentioned these lineages seem to be very old, but some of those threat range endemics have quite a large distribution. Have you looked into the recent gene flow for those species showing a large distribution area, like using microsatellites or something?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I originally had a slide in. Can I answer the questions one by one? Is that appropriate? Is that what you'd like me to do?
No, yeah,
I prefer to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you. Certainly in that image of Cape Range, where there was that very broad species all the way down the peninsula, there has been, in the 90s, there was Alizine work and showed there were very, very distinct genetic provinces. So we think there is substructuring. We've yet to do any microsatellite work, but we are seeing substructuring within places like Cape Range. In the Pilbara, there are some big mesas that are very, very large, and there's very much genetic substructure in there. We have no idea why, largely because we don't understand whether there are barriers inside the mesa or not. In Cape Range, there are definitely barriers because there are big ravines that traverse the entire Cape Range, probably stopping gene flow. We've been looking at it a little bit. Good question.
And how is the laws? You have a special law to protect caves in general, or just fauna?
No, there are no laws to protect caves. It's only the fauna that might happen to occur inside. There are some caves that are protected as tourist areas, so for partly their geological value, but also their social value, that are placed inside national parks in West Australia. They're all protected. But there are no, in West Australia, there are no laws. Do you want to answer this?
I was just
going to
say, yeah.
You need the microphone. So it won't be translated. Thank you.
But the Environmental Protection Authority, one of the things they consider in addition to the fauna and flora is landform. So caves, in their own right,
under that,
but they'd be considering a whole suite of things, not just the
case.
So along the lines of
that. So that's not a law. That's just part of the.
It's not a law, but it is in terms of through the legislation under the Environment Protection Act.
Yes. So the other example where caves and other subterranean cavities are protected as habitat is if there are breeding colonies of threatened species of bats, for example. So certainly in eastern Australia, there are whole very big brood colonies of bats, and the caves become protected because of those. But because of the fauna values, not the cave values.
Thank you, Mark. Very interesting that I was especially interested in something you said just at the end of the lecture. It's about the possibility of protecting species that are not officially named. Is it like that for the whole Australia or only in the Western Australia? And how do you refer to those species? Do you need the genus? And how did you manage to achieve this? Because this is the major problem here in Brazil. And we have a huge resistance. It's not only by the environmental agencies, but it's also a resistance by our colleagues, by our biology colleagues. So how did you manage this? This is a huge advancement.
Mark, just a moment, sorry. We were asked to introduce the speaker, asking questions. So Professor Leonora Trajana from the University of São Paulo, and previously Clayton Lino from the Atlantic Rainforest Network.
I think in Australia, as in places like Brazil, we have such a large taxonomic impediment, which is the lack of having the resources to describe all of the species we found. We know of hundreds, thousands of new species. So I think government very, very quickly realized that to effectively manage these ecosystems, we had to allow the recognition of new species. And we can actually, in Western Australia and in the Commonwealth, we can formally propose and list undescribed species, including undescribed genera of organisms, and get them onto the list with some sort of phrase name. The only I sit on the West Australian Threatened Species Scientific Committee, and all our recommendations, our guidelines, state that it has to be a taxon that's recognised by a competent taxonomist. Okay, and a voucher specimen must be lodged in a public institution. So if it's a plant in the herbarium, if it's an animal in the museum. And so in terms of, I think you asked about phrase names or codes, it doesn't really matter what they're called so long as it's something consistent. We use a particular system in my museum, in my section, in our ecology section. We have a coding system that we use now. I used to think up code names like new species with long legs and three hairs on its head. You know, it just doesn't work anymore, so we give them numbers essentially. But it's recognised by other government agencies because we're the accredited organisation in the state.
Thank you.